This is John Cola with GrowingYourGreens.com. I have another exciting episode for you. And today I'm at another viewer's house. So this is going to be a cool tour for you guys to show you what another viewer is doing. We're here in the Oakland Hills, and most people on this block aren't growing too much edibles in their front yard, although it's actually landscaped very nicely and probably a lot of water conserving plants, which is something I recommend if you aren't growing edibles. Unfortunately, this front yard here still has a lawn that's hopefully going to come out pretty soon, but slowly but surely edibles are being put in its place. And one of the challenges here in this area is that there's a wildlife population of deer and other animals here, and the deer come in and would eat things in the front yard that's not fenced off. So what they've had to do is they took some standard remesh, and this is the concrete mesh available like a big box store or hardware store, usually about $8. It's like a 4x8 sheet. And they just simply put this around all the plants. So they got some actually thornless blackberries, really cool, some squash that's volunteer, and some fruit trees around here, and also some raspberries, I believe. So this is a way that you can protect some of your crops from deer by putting up something like this, or even some kind of bird netting. So fruit trees and shrubs like this are something really easy and low maintenance, you know, to start converting over your front lawn. Especially if you know you have associations or homeowners associations or laws in your city that you can't plant a full-on raised bed garden, but you could probably get away with planting some fruit trees or edible vines and shrubs. Anyways, what we're gonna do next is we're gonna go into the backyard and show you how in this backyard that's actually sloped, some steps were put in and how everything's on a slope and raised beds were built, and there's even chickens in the backyard. So a lot of cool stuff growing on. Let's head to the back and check it out. Now we're inside actually the kitchen, and the backyard is where all the food's growing. And this is very important. You know, if you are making food in your kitchen, you want to have easy access. I like things with easy access. You want easy access to your food. So every night they go out and pick a nice large salad right out this slider. So check it out. We're gonna go out here. And you can see this whole backyard is terraced all the way down. And there's just so many different raised beds. They're all built in stages. Different ones were built in different stages. Like there's beds of greens. There's ones that are done square foot gardening style. There's ones that are in rows. There's like all kinds of stuff, like all kinds of different food crops growing. So what we're gonna do next is we're gonna take you around and show you a few cool things that are growing. Then we're gonna also show you actually the cool composting system that I've never seen anywhere else. And then finally, we're going to talk about seed saving and a unique system that this viewer has come up with to save his seeds. There's a lot of cool crops growing here. I mean, I'm looking at mustard greens. I just saw some mosh, and there's beets and spinach and lettuce and broccoli. I mean, so many different things. I could go around and show you guys everything, but that'd be kind of boring. But what I want to talk about is some crops that are actually just too cool for this garden. And I mean that literally. What's happening here is he's growing some okra. And the okra is just not really doing well. We are here in the Oakland Hills, and we have the Bay influence. It just doesn't get too hot here. He has some peppers growing also, like this guy here and this whole line here. And he's told me that these guys, or the okra and the peppers, just don't really do too well here in this climate zone. And that's because it is too cool for these crops here. So I suggested that he make like a hoop house, and maybe even close in the sides, because in the daytime it gets, you know, fairly warm, but the nights cool down, and actually right now it's actually a fair bit cold. So if it's too cold for me, it's definitely too cold for these guys. They like to keep it a little bit warmer. So even adding some thermal mass in that hoop with like some water or stones to keep in and hold in some of that heat might benefit these guys, and then they'll produce just that much better. So I hope you guys don't have any crops that are too cool for your garden. So next, let's take a look at this unique composting system that's happening. One of the coolest things about this garden is that the composting system is in the tumblers that you see behind me. But the coolest thing about the tumblers is that this was specifically designed to be able to take the wheelbarrow like I got now and drive them underneath the compost tumbler. So check it out. We're gonna drive this up, and there's a nice little runway. You could just drive them right underneath and set your wheelbarrow down, and then walk up the backside here. And this is the compost tumbler. I got the wheelbarrow underneath, and now I got the compost tumbler. And you know, this compost tumbler can be spun. And when it's all ready, you can just open it up and then just let the compost fall into the wheelbarrow and then just wheelbarrow it out into the garden. So this is quite a unique setup here because he is on a terrace or a hill. This is almost natural, a little bit high, and this was totally designed so that the wheelbarrow could be put underneath to spread the wheelbarrow out really easily without having to shovel it out or anything. This is a really smart design, and I might have to do this with my compost tumblers and elevate them up so I can get my wheelbarrow under. Besides just the tumbling compost, he also has a super worm bin that he built just out of wood. So let's check that out next. Here is the worm bin. Now, you know, some people might want to buy a $100 plastic worm bin, and I have showed those on my show before, or you could even get like a Rubbermaid tub and pop some holes in the bottom and keep that as a worm bin. But this is a custom design plywood bin that was custom designed. And this is a flow through type system. So you can see here, we removed some of the bricks here so you could see, instead of just being a box, this box is like actually kind of has a slant to the backside. So what happens is all the compost kind of goes out to the bottom, and then the worms will basically rise up to the top where the food is. So then the goal is to put this on a little hinge or something so it opens up. But right now he could just unscrew it so that all the castings will be on the bottom. Up on the top here, this is on a little hinge here, and this is where he opens it up to feed. So he puts some horse manure in there and also some vegetable scraps for all the worms to eat. And there's actually plenty of them in there. And I believe that worm composting and just general composting in general is really important to build the soil of your garden. It's one of the most important things that you can do, and I believe every gardener should be doing, just like he's doing here. We're sitting next to another raised bed, and in this raised bed he has all kinds of mixed things growing. So he has some sugar snap peas, some different kinds of basils, some collard greens, some tomatoes, and the other thing I want you guys to notice is he's letting some of his crops go to flower and then seed. So the flowers will attract the beneficial insects, which is really cool. Plus, he's saving his own seeds. So this is the carrots. This is an amazing top, flower here. It's in the umbel family. He's also actually has parsnips going to flower, which is cool, which is right behind me there. I never seen parsnips going to flower, so that's really nice for me to see. In addition, he has lettuce, so he's saving his own lettuce seeds too. And this is the lettuce going to flower. So one of the things that's really important to this viewer is saving his own seeds just in case, and to be able to do that. It's also less expensive, and also you're preserving some genetic diversity and potentially creating some new genetic diversity as well. And the thing that I really liked is that he has a unique system to save his seeds. So I'm going to show you guys that because maybe it'll give you guys some ideas if you want to save some seeds and organize and categorize them very effectively. Now we're inside and we're in the seed saving area where all the seeds are kept, and actually this is where he stores his seeds and how he does it. And before I show you guys actually this unique system he made to store his seeds, I want to talk about saving your seeds. Saving your seeds, in my opinion, is one of the most important things you can do in your garden. You're going to, number one, preserve the genetic diversity that you have, and in addition, you may be creating more genetic diversity if some of your plants get promiscuous like they do naturally. So nonetheless, the reason why the seed storage here is really cool is for a few reasons. Number one, he's saving his own seeds. So he has like some little home save seeds that he saved himself in little glass jars with lids. Here's one that he doesn't have a lid on. This is actually the miner's lettuce seed that he grew and saved. And he's probably going to later move this into one of these systematized saving things. So let's show that to you guys next. He built these little boxes out of some wood, and he has everything in little glass containers, and actually these are amber containers, which is really cool. So the number one thing that's the worst for the seeds is the moisture. So these are airtight, they're gonna keep the moisture out. And the other thing you're gonna notice is on the top, he has like letters or numbers. So on this one, it happens to be the letter O, and this is actually printed from his laser printer on like waterproof labels. So he said that you could order these from a special label company that these are waterproof. Like if you just get standard labels that are printable on your laser printer, then they're gonna basically wear out in the water. But these are weatherproof, so you can take these seeds out and open it up and like direct seed them in his garden, or you know, seed them up inside underneath his grow lights or whatever. And each different letter corresponds to a spreadsheet he has going on his computer. And in the spreadsheet, he has information like, you know, the type of plant, you know, for example, carrot. Then he has the variety of the carrot. Then he has things like seed spacing and planting depth and all this other cool stuff, including the variety and specific information about the plant. So that's definitely really cool. So on some seeds, he has larger containers, and this is pretty cool, but he even gets better about this one. And this is another box he made too, which basically has a lid on it so you could take it off. And this is literally his bank of seeds. And what this is literally just two 2x4s that he drilled a bunch of holes in, and he got these little containers that are about, like he said, 50 cents each. And these are little glass vials store some cool stuff in. And in this case, he's storing some seeds. So these are basically, you know, once again, airtight, so the air is not gonna get in there, the moisture is not gonna get in there. Plus they're all like neatly labeled and categorized. So instead of storing your seeds in the standard seed packets, and I'd encourage you guys to get your seeds out of the seed packets as soon as you can, because in the seed packet, they can succumb to moisture. Or if you spill some water in here, your seeds will start to sprout and germinate. And I have seen where people actually take their seeds out in their garden and then the hose gets them wet or it rains on them and these start to germinate and then your seeds are no good. So storing them in something like this is really smart, super intelligent. And now he has these in glass, which I also encourage you guys to store your seeds in glass. And also this is just really cool because now he has all his seeds, like this is probably like about almost 50 seeds, different varieties, in this little holder here that's nice and you have easy access to. So he takes them out of the seed packages and puts them in here. And I think these guys are maybe some pepper seeds, and these guys look like some kind of cucumber seeds to me, but we have to look up what number 37 and what number 25 is. So I definitely really like this system. Plus the other thing he said, if you take this to a seed exchange, all the people will geek out at your cool seed storage system that nobody else has. So besides the seed saving, you know, I talked to the viewer and there's three things that he wants to impart to you from this video that he's imparted to me that's really important to him on being self-sustainable in his garden. Number one, above all else, he says the soil and building your soil is the most important thing you can do. Now, by building your soil, he doesn't mean throwing fertilizers on it like conventional fertilizers from chemicals. He means using compost and worm castings and other things to build the nutrients in your soil, because after all the food that you're growing in your garden is coming from the soil. And if you have soil that's not the best as it could be, then guess what? Your food is not going to be the best it could be either. The next thing that's really important to him is to eat what you're growing and grow what you're eating. I mean, that kind of goes hand in hand. You know, he grows all the stuff he grows. He actually does eat himself or in his family. And, you know, don't waste space on things that you're not going to eat. If you do grow something, you know, for the first time, try to eat it and find unique ways to eat it. Maybe you don't like eating it. Maybe you could blend it up, or maybe you could juice it up. And that way, at least you'll be utilizing it and getting the nutrition out of the plant, which once again came from the soil. Number three, also really important, we just talked about, saving your seeds is critical. If you save your seeds from year to year, no matter what you're growing, whether they're hybrids or heirlooms, you know, and they're cross-pollinating, you're gonna create new varieties that will be more climate sensitized to your specific climate. Maybe if he grows peppers long enough in this climate, and maybe they'll become cool tolerant peppers. I don't know if that'll happen, but you never know what nature's gonna do, because nature adapts. And by saving your seeds, you're gonna bring the adaptations that have happened in your specific garden and your specific location to your seeds. So I hope you guys enjoyed this episode learning what yet another viewer is doing. You know, this was an amazing place to visit. I had actually long chats with this viewer and we actually connected a lot. We have a lot of similar views and we don't agree on everything, but we have a lot of base things that are totally similar, and I respect him highly for doing what he's doing. And hopefully him and you guys out there are gonna also grow more food and be inspired and take some of his suggestions and what's important to him and also make it important for you too. So once again, this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing and saving your seeds too.